A very good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have no apologies this morning, and our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda items 5 and 6 in private. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you. So our next item is consideration of a Scottish statutory instrument, the Discretionary Financial Assistance Scotland Revocation Regulations 2024. This instrument is subject to the negative procedure, and the purpose of the instrument is to bring the discretionary housing payment scheme under the control of Scottish ministers and allow them to issue Scotland-specific statutory guidance. Do members have any comments on the instrument? So I invite the committee to agree that it does not wish to make any further recommendations in relation to this instrument. Are members content to note the instrument?
Yes.
Thank you. So our next is our third evidence session on Social Security Amendment Scotland Bill, which is currently at stage one. The bill amends the Social Security Scotland Act 2018 to make changes to the Scottish Social Security system, and today we will focus on the concerns of carers of potentially vulnerable clients and concerns of clients who have a carer. I welcome to the meeting Fiona Colley, Head of Policy and Public Affairs, Scotland and Northern Ireland, Carers Scotland, and member of National Carer Organisation, NCO, and Vicky Cahill, Policy and Public Affairs Lead, Alzheimer's Scotland. So thank you for joining us today, and thank you all for accepting our invitation. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. So please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking, and don't feel you have to answer every single question as well. And if you've got nothing new to add either to what's been said, that's perfectly okay as well. And I can ask everyone to try and keep questions and answers as concise as possible. So without further ado, I will now move into the questions. So I'm going to invite Bob Dorris to come in first of all. Thank you.
Thanks, Katrina. Good morning, both of you. Thank you for supporting our evidence session this morning. I think probably a relatively straightforward question to start. I think it's uncontentious. Obviously, different benefits have got qualifying deadlines and cut-off dates for which you can apply. And one of the provisions this bill removes, it takes away, it repeals the COVID measures in relation to deadlines. I'm just wondering if witnesses believe there's still suitable flexibility for applying late or after the deadline for benefits with that provision removed. Maybe start with Fiona Colley.
Thank you. We believe there probably is, but we think there's probably some clarity needed on when that flexibility exists. So consideration for delays brought about by caring duties, for example, illness of the carer, not necessary, or the cared for person, and the availability of advice services to support the individual to make an application. So I think just something around public clarification, really transparent, open information about how these flexibilities sit and enabling individuals to make the applications in time.
That's very helpful. So by removing the COVID qualification in relation to this, it also provides an opportunity to give clarity for what those other reasons may be. So you're using this as an opportunity, Ms. Colley, to get that. Vicky Cahill, would you agree?
Yes, so we would absolutely agree that clarity is absolutely paramount to make sure that processes are as transparent and as simplified as possible, both for the decision maker, but also for people who are actually making those applications. There are existing measures within the guidance and regulations, and in practice, permission for late applications is very much part of the norm, as part of social security processes, both for Department of Work and Pensions, but also for Social Security Scotland. And it's our understanding that this approach would be able to be expanded to incorporate some of those reasons, including those by reason of COVID-19, which would satisfy the description as it currently stands in existing guidance that came about before the COVID-19 regulations. So it would satisfy the definition of good reason for a late application, for example, if you were to have reasons related directly to COVID-19. Going back to the point that Fiona has made around the need for clarification, we see this absolutely as an opportunity to review the rules and guidance around both allowing late applications, but also by looking at the backdating of awards and the impact that particularly has, particularly where deadlines are particularly important to be of benefit to applicants wherever possible. So we recognise that claimants might make applications at a time that doesn't allow for a full backdate based on their entitlement, particularly due to the processes that currently exist within Social Security Scotland. So, for example, carers who apply for either carer's allowance as part of DWP processes or carer support payment as part of Social Security Scotland processes, they're only eligible for a 13-week backdate, so that's 3 months from the date of claim. And their entitlement is conditional on the person that they are caring for being in receipt of a disability benefit. So that would include benefits like adult disability payment, attendance allowance and PIP. So it's not unreasonable that a carer might delay making a claim until such times as the person that they care for is in receipt of a particular benefit. However, Social Security Scotland's data indicates, this is January's data, indicates that 8% of claims for adult disability payment, for example, are taking 7 months or more to be processed. So that would mean that, for example, a carer who might be still providing caring duties and responsibilities during that window of time may not be eligible for carer support payment or carer's allowance at this particular time, and therefore they would be disadvantaged if they waited until such time as everything was signed off in terms of that disability benefit payment being put into place. So there is an opportunity there for us to have a look at how that approach to backdating and how processing claims can be made simpler to make sure that people aren't disadvantaged by the processes that currently exist within the system.
Yep. I think that's very clear, Convener. I don't have any follow-up questions because I think you've made your point very eloquently and the committee will reflect on that. So thank you.
Okay. No, thank you very much. And now moving on to theme two, which is challenging decisions, which is part three of the bill. I'm going to invite John Mason in. Thank you.
Thanks, Convener. Now, when it comes to redeterminations, the proposal is that they could be made after a year if there's exceptional circumstances. So in the first place, are you comfortable with this concept of exceptional circumstances and what it actually means, Ms. Cahill?
So I think we do need a bit of clarity around what exceptional circumstances are. So we would suggest that, you know, we look at a broad approach to defining what exceptional circumstances are. We recognise the impact that life events can have in terms of your ability to make an application or to challenge a decision. So that could be ranging from anything from illness, hospital stays, bereavement, grief and loss. They all make a significant impact on your ability to go about doing that. From Alzheimer's Scotland's perspective, though, we are particularly keen to make sure that the impact of living with a cognitive impairment is defined within those exceptional circumstances, and that there's a recognition of the complex needs that arise as a result of living with conditions such as dementia that again might impact on your ability to follow processes within the deadlines and the timeframes that are there. So that is particularly important. But what we also want to be clear about is that it's important that those descriptors and definitions that are used for exceptional circumstances is that they're not overly prescriptive and they're not too narrow in terms of what they permit decision makers to consider, and that each case should be considered on its own merits, and that a determination made by a decision maker is based on a broader understanding of the barriers and challenges that may face claimants. The process generally should allow for some level of discretion, and we would support an approach that would enable that broadest understanding of exceptional circumstances.
I mean, how common would it be, do you think, in practice that somebody would be, you know, after a year they still wouldn't have decided or gone ahead with a request for a redetermination?
So hospital stays, for example, can go on for particularly long periods of time for people with cognitive impairment. You'll all be aware of the challenges that come from for people who are currently unable to be discharged from hospital. There are delays to their ability to either to return to their own home and to be supported, where illness is particularly advanced. Advancing dementia makes it infinitely more difficult to be able to provide those supports. So whilst it's perhaps not the norm to allow that to happen, I think we have to accept that there are cases where that might happen, and that where it's possible for us to make a provision to allow that to be the case and for those individuals who fall under that category to be supported, then it would be important that that provision is made.
Okay, Ms Colley.
Yeah, I'd absolutely agree, and I think in relation to carers, we know from the carer census that about half of carers are providing at least 50 hours of unpaid care. And if you're in the circumstances around things like hospital admission and discharge, if you're in a position of trying to manage multiple caring responsibilities, sometimes you will need a little bit of extra time. And I think that if we can make that clear, I think that we should do. And I think this is a positive development.
I mean, the norm, as I understand it, is either 31 or 42 days for requesting a determination. So, I mean, a year is quite a lot of extra time, isn't it?
It is quite a lot of extra time, but on those particular points around 31 and 42 days, it's a little strange to me that we have different timescales. It makes it very unclear for individuals who are trying to make sense of the social security system. And I think those of us who are enmeshed in it on a daily basis don't sometimes see quite how complicated it is and how off-putting it is and how difficult it can be for individuals to make decisions about how to apply for a benefit in the first place, but then how to make a decision about redetermination or appeal.
42 days, or would you make them all some other level?
I think whatever they are, they need to all be the same. Okay. I think, you know, I think 42 days is in general okay for a lot of people, but to have the flexibility for a longer period, I think, is sensible. But in terms of public information, I think something that's consistent would be helpful.
Okay, thank you. Now, part three, there are certain measures which I think are aimed to reduce stress for clients, things like allowing individuals to withdraw their redetermination request. Are you supportive of that part of the bill?
Yes.
You are, yes. Okay, so straightforward. are there any other measures that you think would improve the client experience for redeterminations and appeals? Either of you?
So there are ways to improve processes and experiences for people who are going through the process of redetermination. It is quite stressful. And whilst the measures do seek to reduce that level of stress, you know, it doesn't remove the stress in its entirety. It simply can move a process along and provides a bit of a buffer in terms of managing timescales and being able to move it along, but it doesn't remove it. What would be helpful, though, would certainly be looking at swifter response times in terms of being able to get that processing done much quicker so that it's not something that sits and weighs heavily on someone whilst they're awaiting for the outcome of a reconsideration, particularly where someone is not in receipt of any kind of financial recompense that recognises the level of disability that they may well have in terms of what it is that they're looking for. For us, it's also very important that we have simplified and easier processes that enable someone to do that, and making sure that there's that clarity and flexibility within the system that allows someone with additional needs to be supported through that entire process from start to finish, whether that be support from a family member or a loved one, or whether that be from a professional who can provide some professional overarching guidance as to how that is.
Point of the, you know, getting a response quickly on that bit, which you've mentioned, that if it would help people if they got a quicker response. I mean, is that working at the moment? And again, there's different targets, but I assume there's different targets for Social Security Scotland because some are more complex to work out than others.
Absolutely. So there are different variations in terms of how different social security benefits are operated within Social Security Scotland. So Social Security Scotland principally looks after disability benefits, which are based on a determination. It's a subjective determination based on someone's level of needs and the requirement for other options to provide support for them, whereas other benefits, for example, where you might have to do a financial piece of decision making based on, you know, statistics and data, is a very different prospect. So there are timescales where that absolutely does vary, but it's important that wherever processes can be expedited, that they should be. So, for example, Social Security Scotland have very good turnaround times when they're dealing with people with terminal illness, for example, under special rules. They are currently meeting three-day target turnaround times for being able to deliver that for initial applications. And so we see that it's important not just for people with terminal illness, but for people with illness or disability more widely to be able to access decisions. But again, with the caveat that they are good, high-quality decisions. So there has to be an adequate amount of time in order to be able to assess and consider it appropriately. However, where it can be speeded up, we should absolutely take steps to do that.
Okay. Ms Colley, do you want a final word on that? I mean, if we speed up decisions, there is a risk of poorer decisions.
Yes, there is a risk, but I think we also need to consider accessible information and accessible support. We know that from the NCO organisation MECOP around the support for those whose first language isn't English, and around 11% of the population in the UK have limited or no English skills. So there's the practical information that's available to individuals, whether that's in different languages, whether that's in Braille or large print, or indeed BSL, that's available as well.
Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. Before we move on, I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in for a supplementary. Thanks.
Good morning. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you, Convener. It was just in regard to representation of your clients. My understanding is that you can tick a box and you can be represent someone for 3 months, but after that you have to go back to Social Security Scotland. Is that causing you any problems, and would it be easier if you could tick a box to say, I want to be represented from the start to whenever the final decision is made?
I think from our perspective, we would suggest that that would make things infinitely easier in terms of not having to retread old ground. However, we would have to build into that system an opportunity for people to step away from that arrangement if that's what they so desired at a later date. So, for example, declaring someone to be their representative or someone who's prepared to act on their behalf, but if they change their mind at a later date and may wish for someone else or for themselves to take on that responsibility, that would have to be built into any system or set up to be able to do that fairly.
Thank you. And then just, I know we're still early days, so there won't have been very many first-tier tribunal hearings yet, but my understanding is that almost all of those are now taking place either online or through the telephone. Is that a disadvantage for the people that you're working for? Would a face-to-face be easier on some occasions, and should that be the norm rather than the exception?
So from an Alzheimer's Scotland perspective, in terms of our dealings with people living with dementia, we would absolutely advocate the position that face-to-face hearings would be significantly easier for the vast majority of people living with dementia who might be in such a position whereby they would have to attend a tribunal. Managing over the telephone or digitally can be very difficult and acts as a significant barrier to a lot of people with dementia. However, we always believe that options are really important. So whilst that may be very difficult for some individuals, for others there may be a preference to use digital or telephone opportunities. So therefore we would suggest that, you know, those opportunities remain in place, and if that is a preference, then that's something that we could be delivering. But equally, that face-to-face for us would be an absolute essential offering for people living with dementia.
Yeah, I would absolutely concur. I think choice is fundamental for individuals and certainly for carers. Sometimes digital can be a lot easier to be able to support someone through that process. However, for others, a face-to-face is much, much more preferable. So I think if we have the options available, and I think it's not optimal for only telephone and digital to be taking place. The face-to-face option must be available.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you very much. That was very helpful. So moving on to theme three, and it's overpayments, which is part four of the bill. I'm going to invite Katie Clarkin. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And appointees and other formal representatives would only be liable for overpayments if they misused the funds, and they would not be liable for honest mistakes. There is also an existing requirement to have regard to financial circumstances before seeking to recover overpayments. Do the witnesses agree with making formal representatives liable in these circumstances? I don't know who would like to come in first.
I'll come in probably fairly briefly. I think the idea of making representatives liable, I think it's a difficulty with overpayments. You know, sometimes there are genuine reasons why people will make an application and they've got it wrong, or a payment's been made and they've got it wrong. And I know there's a provision that you should have noticed. And sometimes that's just not the reality of individuals' lives. So I think there's something about just having a compassion within the system. And we know for unpaid carers there can be significant consequences if there's an overpayment because of the nature of the benefit. I think in general the liability shouldn't be with the individual for who is being represented, that the liability should be with the representative, but we need to be really careful about it, because what we don't want to do is discourage individuals from supporting disabled people, and we also want to take account of the circumstances where an individual may have very significant care and responsibilities, be a power of attorney or a guardian, and be trying to manage the individual's benefits and the household finances, and sometimes it can be really difficult to unpick who the benefit is for, so who is getting benefit from the benefit, too many benefits there. So I just think we just need to be quite clear, but I think within it, I certainly welcome the fact that there's appeal rights within it, and that I think is a good step forward. Mm-hmm.
So we would agree the point that, you know, we do not want to be discouraging people from acting as representatives or appointees at any point, and that people who are prepared to step up should be supported to be able to do that. So we shouldn't put additional barriers in the way of that, absolutely. We do have a few concerns around, you know, how, you know, these determinations as to whether or not funds have been misused might be determined. So, for example, it might be quite difficult to identify what might be covered by this particular scenario in terms of determining what is misuse of funds. So, for example, disability benefits like adult disability payment don't prescribe how people in receipt of those benefits or representatives who are responsible for administering those benefits on behalf of someone who perhaps can't manage their own affairs about how they should be spent, you know, and making determinations of what is misuse could actually potentially be quite difficult. So when there's no direct requirement for you to provide or purchase particular things with your benefit, who is to say that, for example, going on holiday or going out socially or purchasing a vehicle is a misuse of funds when actually that could be for the benefit of the individual for whom the benefit is being claimed. So that in and of itself can be quite challenging. Likewise, we believe that there might be some difficulty in identifying the difference between an honest mistake and you know, something that's perhaps more around making a deliberate attempt to gain benefit from doing so. So, for example, how might it be determined if an omission of information is as a result of a genuine oversight or a lack of knowledge or understanding of the process? Or what is a deliberate concealment of information in order to gain some benefit? So, for example, you know, if an individual enters hospital, there's a requirement for them to declare that to Social Security Scotland. At a time of great stress and juggling lots of different things, it could be quite easy for that to be an oversight in terms of doing that. Where do we draw the line then in terms of then determining what is the difference between a direct attempt at concealment in order to continue to benefit from that payment and what is genuinely simply an oversight and nothing more than that? So that can be quite difficult. So we would generally reiterate the point that there needs to be fair and reasonable processes and that there needs to be quite clear and robust structures in place that can support carers and representatives. But equally, we also have to make sure that there's ongoing support as part of that process to reduce the likelihood that such an event might not occur again in the future. So it's not simply about looking at a single instance, it's about looking at the wider picture as well.
Thank you. That's very helpful. And the person being cared for can already be liable for noticeable overpayments caused by the representatives, and the bill extends this to include overpayments where a person would not necessarily notice that they were a result of an honest mistake by their representative. And do you agree with that? I don't know if Fiona would like to come in first again.
I think probably no. If someone has a representative acting for them, that is because they require support to manage their social security, and I don't think there should be a position where they are liable for that. I think that seems fundamentally unfair.
Thank you.
Okay. I would absolutely agree with the comments that Fiona's made there. I think it's unfair and unreasonable to expect claimants with additional support needs clearly evidenced by their need for a representative in the first instance, you know, to have to take on that role and that responsibility of doing checks and balances and making sure that, you know, all information is done on their behalf. So I think, yeah, we would absolutely make the point that we would consider that to be very unfair.
Okay, thank you.
No, thanks very much. And following on from that theme, I'm going to invite Ros McCollan. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you very much for coming along. Yeah, I am going to continue on this theme. Obviously, the balance of this has got to be right, and certainly the evidence we're taking is that this is very fine movements that we're looking at. But following a bereavement is really where I'm wanting to focus on. It is possible that the deceased benefits could be overpaid in this instance. So do you have any comments on the ability to recover benefit overpayments from the estate of an individual who has died? Fiona, I'm going to start with you and then come to Vicky. But obviously this is very specific, but I'd be intrigued to know what you think on it.
Yeah, it's a difficult... I don't think I need to tell anyone in this room. It's a really difficult time when you lose someone. And if you particularly have lost someone that you're caring for, There's a lot of things that you need to deal with, and just the practicalities of being able to deal with things like a funeral, things like stop and care services, things like equipment. It grows and grows and grows and grows. And I think we just need to be a little careful about understanding those circumstances and having a compassionate approach to this. I think in general, I know that it's in line with other benefits, for example, pension credit, where there's fairly immediate, you've got to pay this money back. And that can be really, really distressing. And I can speak to somebody who has actually been in that position, and it's really distressing when you're trying to deal with everything else. So I think there's just something about a bit of balance in there, just to make sure that the individuals aren't being placed under additional stress. And estates can be very variable. I mean, let's be honest, somebody's estate could be minuscule. And when you're actually talking about paying for funerals and things like that as well, there can be nothing left, and then there's an attempt to reclaim. So I think just something about balance and compassion in it.
Thank you. Vicky.
Thank you. So yes, we would agree that there is absolutely a need for sensitivity in terms of managing the winding up of people's estates. That includes considerations around the timing for requests, but also having a look at the correspondence that's sent out. The current correspondence that's used, both by Department for Work and Pensions and also by Social Security Scotland, initially offers some degree of condolence to the individual in question responsible for doing so, and then the next line is literally a demand for money. That is not the most compassionate and appropriate way in which to make a request for additional funds. There are opportunities for you to write out to Debt Recovery, who are responsible for taking in any overpayment that has occurred as a result of death. However, those processes are not particularly clear and not widely known, particularly amongst the public. So perhaps there is an opportunity at that point to think about what those processes might be and under what circumstances someone might be able to request that the overpayment is written off by Social Security Scotland. For example, if money has been paid as a result of simply the payment processes that are in place. So, for example, some benefits are paid 3 weeks behind and 1 week ahead, which would automatically result in an overpayment. That's not as a result of anybody declaring late or you know, delaying notifying Social Security Scotland. So there should perhaps be some flexibility built into the system that takes into account, you know, those wider parameters in order to be able to support people at a really difficult time.
That's very helpful. I was going to ask for a couple of suggestions of what you meant by balance, but you've just given me them. So thank you very much indeed. And no further questions.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Now, moving on to theme four, which is appointees, which is part five of the bill. I'm now going to invite Paul O'Kane in. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the witnesses. I suppose perhaps just as a broad question, you know, what experience do you have in terms of the appointee system, both under DWP and Social Security Scotland as it stands? So what's your kind of experience of that process been?
So in terms of Social Security Scotland's processes, we have very limited access. Obviously, they are relatively new, so the opportunities for engagement around that have been much more limited. In terms of processes for Department for Work and Pensions, we have a bit more scope in terms of how that works. And broadly, we haven't come across significant challenges around appointeeship. We are not dealing with significant numbers of people who are having difficulty either being recognised as an appointee or who are having difficulty in changing details or being used as that particular individual. So that would be the extent of our experience at the current time.
Yeah, I'm just concurring with that, but you've not really had any. We've had the odd inquiry around the DWP processes, but in the main, it seems to work. effectively?
Obviously, the bill requires DWP appointees to be authorised by Social Security Scotland as soon as reasonably practical. What are your general expectations on how long it should take Social Security Scotland to authorise an appointee? Because, you know, we had a discussion, I think, with other witnesses just about, you know, timescales, expectations and that sort of thing. So it would be good to get your sense of that.
I would say I probably haven't got a particular timescale in mind. I think for us it would be something that is within the timescale of the payment of the benefit. So if it was something around a monthly, a three-weekly, one-weekly benefit that there's that is within that period. So the next time the individual has to make any contact that actually they're in the position of being able to be an appointee for Social Security Scotland. I think I would note that in the early discussions around the DWP to Social Security Scotland and having to change that, just a general frustration that there hasn't been able to be an automated way of doing this.
So we recognise that there's a need for due process to be undertaken and that the actual process itself does take a bit of time because that has to be determined by the capacity of Social Security Scotland to be able to carry out those processes. So processes include face-to-face visits, speaking to both the person who wishes to be an appointee and in most circumstances the person who wishes to appoint someone to act as their representative. So that can take a bit of time. In addition, we recognise that sometimes additional information is also required. So, for example, that could be medical reports or something which helps to make the determination as to the reasonableness of the request for someone to act as a representative. So, again, within that kind of timescale, we believe would absolutely be perfectly reasonable to request, but we are aware that it's very much based on the capacity of Social Security Scotland to be able to deliver that. It is possible, though, to speed up the process of checks if they've already previously been carried out by the Department for Work and Pensions. You know, and it's possibly worthwhile having a look at what agreements can be arranged between Department for Work and Pensions and Social Security Scotland reciprocally in both directions, where perhaps some of the checks that have been carried out by DWP, that information could be shared to enable Social Security Scotland or DWP in the reverse to carry out, you know, just a quick oversight of that, particularly, for example, if someone has had an appointeeship organised within the last 6 to 12 months. It wouldn't seem unreasonable to place the administrative burden onto Social Security Scotland rather than the expectation being placed on either the claimant or, and the claimant's representative to have to take on additional burdens as part of that. So perhaps something around some kind of memorandum of understanding or other reciprocal agreement might be a worthwhile route to consider, particularly for people who are claiming benefits from both Department for Work and Pensions, such as pension or the pension service, actually pension credit, universal credit, but then maybe, for example, claiming a disability benefit here from Social Security Scotland.
Thank you. Those answers are helpful. And just in terms of some of the practical suggestions, because I think I'm sensing the kind of frustration about perhaps blockages, if I can use that expression, in the system. Obviously, the bill will create empowering opportunities, if you like, to do that. But obviously a lot of the detail then comes in terms of how it operates in practice. I mean, do you feel that Social Security Scotland are engaging in terms of some of those suggestions you made, Vicky, for example, or that conversation about a more automated process from Fiona?
So my understanding is that Social Security Scotland and Department for Work and Pensions are engaging and they are looking at ways to work alongside each other and to support claimants. I think that's ultimately the crux of what we have to get to. So it's not about, you know, individual bodies and authorities taking, you know, that approach of, you know, they overrule the other because of the geography. I think ultimately what the aim of the bill and what the aim of practice, most importantly, is about supporting claimants to get what they need as quickly as they possibly can and without any further additional barriers to what already exists within the system itself.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's something around, you know, I do understand that Social Security Scotland does have to have a due diligence in relation to this, but there seems to be a... We have one public body that's already made a decision with a range of information that it is appropriate to have an appointee. Again, whether that can be simply transferred. And I know this has been a challenge, and it was a challenge around child disability payment. But some agreements between the DWP and Social Security Scotland, I think, would be most sensible, and I think really would take the pressure off individuals, because ultimately, as Vicky said, it's about ensuring that individuals get the support they need and get it quickly and don't have additional stresses to have to deal with.
Thank you. Convener.
Okay. No, thanks very much. Moving on to theme five, which is information for audit. I'm going to invite Marie McNair in now. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. It's great to see you this morning. Do you agree with part six of the bill and, you know, the ability to spend people's benefit payments if they repeatedly fail to provide the information required to Social Security Scotland?
I suppose I could give a kind of mixed message to that one, of a kind of yes and no. I think the information within this section is pretty unclear. I think we need a lot more information about the intention and the scope and where an individual may or may not understand what's being asked of them. So there may be very good reasons why they're not actually engaging. And so I think there's something about we need to make sure that if this part of the bill goes forward, that there's very good information available for advisers, but also for the public, because there's good information on the Social Security Scotland website around the benefits themselves, but not some of these more tricky parts that are for accessible for individuals, not for advisors who have a very different technical understanding of the Social Security system.
Thank you. Okay.
So we'd absolutely agree with the point that Fiona has made. We would iterate the point that suspending payments doesn't really align with social security principles, and so therefore I'm sure it's no shock that, you know, we would disagree with that particular approach. There are some issues around you know, the language and the wording that's used, and that's where the clarity that Fiona has asked for is really imperative. So for example, defining the term repeatedly, what does that mean? Does repeatedly mean, you know, how many times does repeatedly mean? What methods of contact are we going to be using in order to be able to try and establish contact with someone? Is it going to be a continuation of the same, where if you don't get a response the first time around, are we going to repeat the exact same process the second time around, and so on? So therefore, we do require much more clarity in terms of how that will actually play out from a practical point of view. I think also from Alzheimer's Scotland's perspective, we need to have a really clear understanding about the needs of people living with dementia. They're often older people, although not always, and they have sometimes very difficult, complex needs. And in order for them to be able to engage or be part of a process of sharing and providing information, takes a lot of effort on the part of the person requesting the information, not just the individual who is being asked to provide it. So we need to think about things like, how is information being communicated? How is it possible for decision makers or people who are requesting this information to explore the needs of claimants and making sure that their needs are being met and that they can be supported to provide what it is that they have been asked to do? and looking at alternatives. Are there other ways to obtain the same information that perhaps doesn't place such a significant burden on an individual? Are there other routes in order to be able to access that information? So I think generally, you know, we would suggest that there are other ways and means of being able to look at information again. If there is any suggestion of any, you know, or significant evidence of particular wrongdoing, then that has to take a slightly different approach. But where we're looking at reviews of information or where we're trying to establish conditionality based on eligibility criteria, then perhaps the burden lies perhaps more with the decision maker than with the individual who is receiving the benefit.
Thank you. I think you've kind of answered my next question, obviously, with the kind of supports that the clients would need. Obviously, you're saying that information is key to the client to understand the process. Fiona, anything else you kind of want to add?
I think also time. I think I can't emphasise that enough in relation to carers. They're very time poor. It's one of the things that carers consistently say to me, that actually sometimes caring is the least stressful part of it. All of the bureaucracy around it, and that includes social security, is hugely stressful and hugely time consuming. I'd also want to note around ensuring that we do have accessible information. And that there's protections for those who have protected characteristics, including ensuring that the information is available in the language that they need it in, whether that is a language different to English, whether that's in Braille or large print, or whether that's BSL, and that the individuals are very well aware what information can be provided to them and in a form that they need, and they've got a right to it. And I think that you have a right to information in a way that you understand it, and that includes things like ensuring, as a person with with cognitive impairment, that the information that you receive is understandable. And sometimes letters from bureaucracies are not necessarily that understandable for anyone.
So just to reiterate the need for accessibility is absolutely key in order to encourage participation, and also about going back to that point about having choice and having options that are available to you. So, you know, we might be providing written materials, we might be thinking about audiovisual materials, digital online options. Face-to-face, sometimes speaking to someone directly just to have an opportunity to discuss actually what information is needed, why is it needed, having a face-to-face conversation with someone who can explain it in a way that makes it more accessible, more relatable, is really important. So again, not everyone's needs will be exactly the same, and it's about exploring what an individual claimant's needs are. So those options and choices absolutely have to be available.
Thanks for that, Vicky. That's me, convener.
Okay, thank you very much. And our last theme is on social security principles, and I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
Thank you. And we're coming towards the end, you'll be glad to hear. I wonder, do you have any comments or any other specific measures that are in the bill that you haven't had a chance to comment on yet?
So from our own point of view, we just kind of go back to the points around compensation recovery. We referenced this in our written response around compensation recovery, and to reiterate the point that sometimes people have multiple conditions or disabilities which will coincide with an injury or illness that might come about as a result of an accident or injury for which someone's being compensated. We feel it's really important that an individual who might otherwise be entitled to benefit, notwithstanding the issue related to the compensation, that should absolutely be taken into account. So, for example, someone with a dementia may have symptoms, whether or not they have a diagnosis. That should absolutely be taken into account before any recovery measures are put into place that would potentially disadvantage someone. So that should be a slightly broader approach in terms of ensuring that we're not just looking at the compensation award in its sole existence. We have to look much broader and beyond that to look at the wider circumstances of someone who's had a compensation award.
Yeah, I think I probably want to concur with that. I think that there are often additional hidden costs. And these could be things like adaptations, reasonable expenses, and also the fact that for some compensation payments that they're about support for the rest of someone's life. I think we just need a little bit of compassion, and I think that's something that's been really important, I think, around the creation of Social Security Scotland. And the benefit system about dignity, respect and compassion, and ensuring that everything we do, including the recovery of compensation payments, is thoughtful and compassionate and considers all the circumstances that individuals and their carers are living in.
Thank you, that's really helpful. If I can open up slightly wider, this is a chance for us as a committee and for Parliament to review the Act that was passed. Is there anything you would like in the bill that's not in the bill? I appreciate you've only got a few minutes, so I just could go on for a long time. But
I think the opportunity to create new support within the bill, we have some thoughts around that, around particularly support around energy costs, and I think this opens up potentially that opportunity to look at what is missing from the initial creation and the benefits that are being transferred. It's been brilliant that the Scottish Child Payment has been created. We would probably argue that assistance should be extended to, the eligibility should be extended to those who receive who have children who receive carers allowance. But I think there's other opportunities to have a think about what's missing and what we've learned over the past years and months, cost of living and how energy costs have gone through the roof, particularly for disabled people.
I think possibly in addition to the suggestion that Fiona's made about extending the scope for social security here in Scotland, I think also thinking about those supports and measures that people might need to access and providing a clearer, easier pathway to ensure that people can access the kind of professional support that they might need to navigate a system that is as complicated and challenging sometimes as social security. So I think potentially having a look at how we can structure that support, which often comes from the third sector, although we do have some provision within local authority arrangements, but they're hugely variable. So perhaps worthwhile having a consideration of how we make that a much more fair and even playing field for people to be able to access the support that they need to navigate their way through the system.
Thank you. Do you think the bill aligns with the Social Security principles? It's a good exam question.
So I think broadly speaking, they do align with the principles, with the exception of those around information audit. I think I was quite clear earlier in my response that suspending payments doesn't align with the principles of the bill. But otherwise, I think broadly, yes, they do align.
Yeah, very quickly, I shall agree with that perspective.
I think you've probably picked this up, but just one final opportunity. In regard to the client experience, obviously you've just caveated with what you said, but out with that, is there anything there that you're still concerned about the client experience, either things that need to be in to make it easier or things which need to come out to make it easier? I mean, I think you've probably covered a lot of that already, but just your kind of final sweep up, if you've got any other final comment to make.
I think broadly where we seek clarity is around how operationally the bill will be practically exampled within its use within Social Security Scotland's processes and practice. So we do absolutely need some clarity around, you know, how particular processes will work, what safeguards will be put in place, and whether or not they will be sufficient to meet the needs of vulnerable claimants. Particularly, I think the move towards you know, these new steps in the bill largely seek to try and improve the experience of claimants and their representatives. However, the proof is in the pudding, so as to put it, and that will be very much from how it's actually played out in actual practice and day-to-day experiences. So we will wait and see.
I think I would agree on that, and I think I suppose to emphasise the need for clarity, the need for good information, the need for accessible information. You know, we agreed that social security is a human right, and we actually need to make that practically real for everybody who applies. And that includes ensuring that across the piece we encourage take-up, and we encourage take-up of social security within the reserved system as well, and we make the pathway for individuals as smooth as possible.
Thank you very much, and also thank you both for all the work that your organisations do. I know you help so many people, so thank you for today as well.
Okay, thank you very much. I believe Bob would like to come in.
Just very briefly, I was very impressed with our witnesses' answers in relation to Mr Balfour's call for what more would you like to see. Ms Cawley quite rightly made a call for greater financial support and greater consistency in that financial support across groups. And Ms Cahill spoke about improved pathways, which would have a financial implication, but not as much, of course, as the direct financial support. Of course, it's not for the witnesses here to see where that money would come from. Of course not. You should champion the corner for those that you're representing. I am conscious that the Scottish Government spends £1.1 billion more on entitlements to those who are vulnerable, needing support, than they get in finances from the UK Government. So there's clearly a divergence between the funds available to support those who need extra help and that extra help that's required because of the UK situation. I'm not drawing you on any of that. I'm genuinely not. The question, and that's the context of the question. The question is, what advice would you give government or this committee? Because with a limited budget, we've got a very difficult job in weighing up where the next, Ms Cawley, this is not the situation, but if £10 million was to become available, it's not, I'm afraid, but if it was, how does the Scottish Government determine what area to invest that money in? Because some would argue to increase the Scottish Shell payment further, others would argue to increase the entitlement to that, or spend in a whole other area, carers perhaps. How does this committee or the Scottish Government reconcile those competing demands? So you should make those demands, absolutely. I would expect you to do so. You do so powerfully, passionately and persuasively. But how do we reconcile those tensions?
It'd be nice if there was a £10 million. I can think of many ways to spend that. I think when we look at some of the poverty figures, so the poverty for unpaid carers, but equally the poverty for disabled people, I think about half of households have someone with a disability in that household. And I think we really need to think of the cost of not supporting people, and the costs are borne elsewhere. And it's a really difficult conversation to have when we talk about prevention and health inequalities, that actually if you spend on something that will reduce the health impact, that there's a reduction in cost elsewhere, because sometimes it takes a while to see that cost come through. So that's where we tend to come in terms of the balancing is that the poverty that disabled people and their carers face is so huge, and it is such an impact on their health and well-being that is paid for elsewhere in the Scottish budget, that actually we need to have a bit of a think about the prevention and where investing can help reduce that part of it.
Thanks, Ms. Collin. That doesn't solve the quandary that government and this committee finds ourselves in, but again, a very persuasive argument that you make, Ms. Cahill.
So yes, part of it is about whole system, you know, design, and looking at the general kind of infrastructure and where you maximise the potential for future cost savings. So again, it's that hitting things further upstream, which is obviously a preventative approach, and talking about early intervention, which can then prevent further costs. It's a really difficult challenge to lay bare, and not a challenge that has any quick or easy answers. Otherwise, I'm sure you would all have come up with them by now. But certainly that whole system approach is really important. What I would add is the importance of having a look at, you know, that lived experience and where you can make that impact. Listening to people in terms of their experiences on the ground and where you can make those particular changes. Naturally, I will advocate for people living with dementia, people living with long-term complex care needs, absolutely. I'm sure others can make equally sound representations for people within other parts of society, absolutely. However, what we need to be thinking about is a much longer term strategy, which will then make sure that, you know, each of the areas that we are all trying to kind of push forward and champion actually have the ability from the system that exists as it is now to move forward with that, and then, you know, be able to see improvements, and so that the actual experiences on the ground are better. And it's thinking about, you know, what impact can you make with the money that you have? You know, if a problem requires £100 million and you have £10 million, what advantage is there in throwing £10 million at it? It might well be nothing. However, if we're looking at something where, you know, 10 million can make a specific change or can make a specific improvement, then that experience for people on the ground will be very, very different. So again, you know, the success of the Scottish Child Payment examples that. So you've been able to show that by having that particular pocket of money and directing it and targeting it at a very particular group of individuals, you can create that change and that impact in a way that it's felt quite acutely by those who receive that benefit. So again, it's not a quick fix, but it is about looking at, you know, where can you maximise that impact.
Thank you. No other questions, Convener, but can I just put on record that thank you to both witnesses for championing so passionately the way that you do, and it's very helpful to this committee. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you very much. So this concludes this evidence session, and on behalf of the committee, I very much appreciate you joining us today. So thank you very, very much. Next week, we will continue to take evidence on the bill with a panel focusing on part 7 of the bill, which concerns recovery from compensation payments. So I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow for the set-up of our next item. Thank you.
Welcome back. Our next item on the agenda is a presentation on the additional costs of disability in Scotland. The committee commissioned a piece of research on the topic in March last year to inform its scrutiny work. And following a call for bids, the research was awarded to a joint bid by the University of Strathclyde and the Poverty Alliance. So I welcome to the meeting two of the authors, Christy McFadgen, Knowledge Exchange Associate Economics, Fraser of Allender Institute, University of Strathclyde, and Dr. Laura Robertson, Senior Research Officer, the Poverty Alliance. So thank you both for joining us today. And I believe you will first take us through a presentation of your work and findings. Thank you.
Yep, thank you very much for having us. So I'll start and then I'll pass on to Laura for some of our work. So just for context, I've been working more on the sort of quantitative side of this research and Laura more on the qualitative side. So if you could direct your questions maybe in that sense, it will probably make more sense for us. But we'll try to be as good as we can on both sides of it. So additional costs faced by disabled people are recognised as being detrimental to quality of life. For any given income, disabled people are not able to realise the same standard of living as a non-disabled person. Additional costs are many and varied, and they depend on individual circumstances, including type of disability, household composition, and rurality. These additional costs are concerning not only from the point of view of fairness, but the impact of poorer living standards is also potentially significant and can lead to poorer outcomes in relation to well-being and health over both the short term and the long term. So in recognition of higher additional costs for disabled people, a system of disability benefits has long been established as part of the UK social security system, and it's now part of the devolved benefit system in Scotland. The Social Security Scotland Act 2018 states that Scotland's social security system will be designed based on evidence. However, to our knowledge, there's no Scotland-specific baseline of the scale of additional costs faced by disabled people. This report takes a step towards a better understanding of the additional costs of disability in Scotland. We've looked at the limited data available to analyse the scale of additional spending faced by disabled people in Scotland, and then to contextualise and supplement our findings from the national survey data that we've used, we've also worked with six disabled Scottish residents who have provided information about their extra costs and their experiences of accessing support to us through weekly diaries and interviews over a five-week period. So, just in terms of definitions, in this research we refer to the Core Equality Act definition of disability, which states that a person is disabled if they have a physical or mental impairment which has a substantial and long-term negative impact on their ability to do normal activities. So in this context, long-term refers to a condition that lasts or is expected to last 12 months or more, and substantial refers to the condition having a non-trivial impact on daily activities. So a bit later we'll talk about severity of disability. Normally in national surveys, people who are referring to their disability can say they're either limited in their daily activities a little or a lot. So when we talk about severity and a more severe disability, we're referring to that a lot category. So a preview of our findings before we take you through them properly. Our findings show that the best available data is far from perfect and can't tell us enough at this stage. We find some evidence of additional spending in food, energy and health, and we find less spending by disabled households in transport. We can't say whether the additional costs in the spending data we used are statistically significant because of small sample sizes, but they are persistent over time, which gives us some trust that they are true effects. Data on spending also, importantly, doesn't capture needs that are not being met due to a lack of income, or what support is being received that may already compensate for additional costs. So we'll start off by going through what the data can tell us. So I'll start off with our findings across all disabled versus non-disabled households in Scotland, and then Laura will take us through some of our qualitative findings as well. And then we'll go into some of the breakdowns we've done, including urban versus rural households, and some more stats on severe disability and extra spending there. So, first of all, just a bit of intro on the data that we use in this report. It's from a survey called the Living Costs and Food Survey. So this survey contains expenditure data for individuals and households across the whole of the UK. This is the best expenditure data that we have available for our purposes, since it's designed to be representative of the UK population. It indicates whether each household member has a disability, and it allows us to look at Scotland specifically. So we have supplemented this with findings from the weekly diaries that I mentioned. So that's from 6 disabled people in Scotland over a 5-week period, and those diaries took place in January and February of this year, 2024. So, just as a bit of context, the diaries are not designed to represent all disabled individuals. We would never claim to do that with just 6 diaries. Instead, they're there to provide context of the lived experience of additional costs related to disability, including the potential drivers of these costs and other available support and how that kind of interacts with people's lives. And also, we wanted to look at the impact of the continued higher costs of living in 2024, which the data that we have can't provide, since it's data from 2021 to 2022 is the latest that we have available. So, in our report, if you have copies available, you can have a look at Table 1 and Figure 1. So what these figures show is the additional spending by disabled households in Scotland compared to non-disabled households across 4 essential categories. These categories are food, energy, transport and health. So a bit of a primer on how to read these figures, because I know it might not be quite intuitive. So a positive number in these boxes means that disabled households are spending more. So what we're looking at here is, like, if you take, for example, say a non-disabled household spends £20 per week on health expenditure. If a disabled household was to spend £21 per week, so £1 more, then the box there would say a positive number 1. So we'd be looking at that difference between spending. So what we've looked at is the total spending, the mean total spending across these categories, and then we've subtracted disabled households minus non-disabled households. So we have that difference in there. So if it's a positive number, then that means disabled households are spending more, and if it's a negative number, that means non-disabled households are spending more. So our main findings here is that we do have slight extra spending from disabled households on food, energy and health, and we have less spending on the transport category. So actual spending is a lot more variable than the means show, due to different household incomes, and this is why we split the sample into income groups. So Our goal with this was to, instead of comparing, say, a disabled household on a really low income with a non-disabled household on a really high income, we don't want to be comparing those because spending is probably wildly different anyway. What we wanted to do is compare like with like. So we've split our sample of households into 5 equally sized categories. So income group 1 is the lowest incomes. So it's the sort of 20% lowest incomes, and income group 5 is the 20% highest incomes. So we're always comparing disabled versus non-disabled households that have similar levels of income to kind of understand where the differences are. And so the figure that we have, the chart there, shows across all income groups. So you can see the variety across income groups. And then the table shows you the mean difference in expenditure. So for food, we've got 0, for energy we've got 1, for transport we've got -17, and for health we've got 2. So we've seen slight additional spending across food, energy and health, and we're seeing less spending in transport. So one thing to note on this is, obviously, we've got the mean of the food expenditure being 0, so we're not seeing additional spending once we average everything out across the 5 income groups. But when we looked at previous years, we did see additional spending in food. So there's a potential effect of inflation here. Because all low-income households will have spent more of their income on food in 2021 to 22, households, if they have a limited amount of money they can spend on food each week, then this limit could be reached faster in disabled households than non-disabled households due to additional costs associated with disability. So this is something that Laura will touch on a lot more, but it was kind of one of our first realisations when we were looking at this data that we're not seeing any unmet need in this data. We're only seeing what people are able to spend money on. We're not seeing what people are unable to spend money on. So yes, and then in terms of transport, so our data shows that disabled households spend less than non-disabled households on transport. We believe that this effect is down to a combination of factors. So first of all, disabled people take less trips on average than non-disabled people. We've got evidence from that from the Department of Transport and across a UK study in 2017. And secondly, disabled people are more likely to have access to free transport via a free bus pass or similar. So again, that's just kind of a reiteration that this is only spending data. We're not seeing use of services in here. So that's something we'll touch on a bit later. Social support may be covering expenditure that we would otherwise see in here if that social support wasn't available. So Laura's now going to talk about one of our case studies from our diaries.
Oh, thanks, Kirsty. So just to give you a bit of context about the diaries as well. So as Kirsty's mentioned already, the diaries has specifically looked at the needs that are not being met for a group of six disabled people that took part in that part of the research. Of the six participants, there was one who was in employment, one who was a student, and four who were receiving universal credit or employment support allowance alongside personal independence payment, and one participant was getting adult disability payment. Just to start off with a bit of a summary of the diary participants. So, four of the six participants said that they were going without basic essentials every week during the five-week diary exercise. And five of the six participants said that they were finding it quite challenging or very difficult to manage on their incomes every week as well. I've got to touch on one specific case study, a man with a physical disability who uses a wheelchair in receipt of personal independence payment and with high mobility and middle care, and also receiving employment and support allowance. So across his diaries, he reported mainly finding it very difficult to manage on his income. And he had a range of additional costs for his disability, and some of those are outlined in the briefing that you have. So in particular for him, costs around taxes, but also energy costs. And energy costs were key across all six participants' diaries as one of the highest costs. There is also specific treatments that he was having to pay for as well, and he also had to hire people to help with household cleaning and other household tasks. So in terms of the diary and what he was sharing every week, he was experiencing it was a very cold time in January and February, so the bad weather had meant that he'd had to use his storage heaters frequently, and in one week of his diaries he recorded that the costs come for £100 for storage heaters that week. High costs of food and heating in that particular week meant he shared that he'd had to borrow money from his family because the income he was receiving through ESA alongside what he got from PIP was not sufficient. In most of his diary entries, he had not been able to get his basic essentials every week, so basic things like food or energy costs. And he a quote from his diary is that he often has to make difficult choices between heating and eating. Another effect of the high costs was having to cut back on social activities outside of his home as well. So there's obviously effects there in terms of isolation and loneliness as well.
So I'm now going to talk a bit more about the breakdowns that we've done in the data. So first of all, on looking at additional spending for those with more severe disabilities. So we see similar results in the LCFS data when we compare those with a severe disability to all other households. So that's including comparing them to those with less severe disabilities. The only obvious difference in the data for those with more severe disabilities is that they have less additional spending associated with health spending. We think this could potentially be due to those with more severe disabilities being more likely to draw on NHS care for their condition rather than relying on over-the-counter options. But we can't say the exact reason from this, from the data above, well, from the data alone. In Table 2 and Figure 2, we've had to omit income group 5 because they had a sample size of less than 10 observations for those who are severely disabled in that high income group. So this is just to kind of highlight again the limitations of this data. When we're taking a survey that's around 5,000 households across the UK, about 20% of those are Scottish, and then we cut by disability, we cut by severity, we're getting down to kind of really low numbers of households that we can look at, and so it kind of shows the limitations of the current data that we have in terms of when we want to collect evidence. It's harder to do so, and it's harder to, for it to be reliable when we have these smaller sample sizes. So in terms of urban versus rural areas, we also looked at differences here. So figure 3 shows that those in urban households seem to be spending more than rural households in the spending categories of food, energy and transport. So at first glance, this may seem somewhat surprising since we know that rural areas often face additional costs compared to urban areas. So as I said before, sample sizes become even smaller when we split disabled households by urban versus rural areas, meaning we're even less sure that we can trust these figures compared to the already kind of volatile Scottish averages. But it is possible that what we're seeing here is the extra cost of living in a rural area overshadowing the additional costs related to having a disability. So similar to what I'd said before about if people have a limit to the amount they can spend on essential categories, it may just be that disabled households are hitting that limit faster and they're simply not able to spend more on that amount. So we're not seeing that evidence in the spending data. We do, however, see evidence in Figure 3 that disabled households in rural areas are spending more in the health category, and we're not sure why this would be and why that's coming out differently to the food, energy and transport. So a further interesting difference is the large difference in spending on transport between urban and rural areas for disabled households compared to non-disabled households. We're not sure whether this is a true effect or a result of poor data as mentioned above. If it is a true effect, then one factor which could contribute to this is relatively fewer public transport options in rural areas, which could act as a barrier if private transport isn't an option for households. So we've gone over what the survey data can tell us. As mentioned above, the findings from the LCFS are variable and small sample sizes become an issue when we analyse urban and rural areas and those with more severe disabilities. There aren't extra costs in every household, in every disabled household in Scotland, and so that creates overlap, which means we can't say whether these results are statistically significant or not. But they are, as I said before, persistent over time. Which makes us more confident. And I've also included UK-wide results for comparison in the appendices if you're interested in looking at those, and they show similar trends. And yes, importantly, a part of why we've included the diaries in this research is that data on spending cannot quantify financial difficulty. So Laura's going to talk a bit more about the findings from the diaries now.
Thank you. So I'm going to talk through two other case studies from two of the participants. I'm going to touch on some of the consequences are on their day-to-day lives of struggling on their incomes and particular costs that they'd identified that they were struggling to meet. There was, across the sample, there was examples of participants having to get financial support from family, friends, or considering getting a loan because they were struggling. And energy-related debt also was mentioned by two of the participants as well. We also included a prompt for any additional forms of support that they might have accessed. So we wanted to find out about things outside of benefits, so like social care support, for example. And one of the participants was receiving self-directed support for 10 hours a week, but the rest of the participants weren't. But two of them were using their disability benefits to pay for social care. There was one participant who had accessed a Scottish Welfare Fund crisis grant 1 week, and another who was struggling with her energy costs had received the Warm Homes discount. But apart from that, there were no other forms of additional financial support mentioned in over the 5 weeks for each of the participants. So the diaries really reveal on a weekly basis how much the participants are having to plan and make adjustments to try and lower their spending. High cost of living for energy and food were mentioned frequently. So one participant said, "I combined all my journeys outside of the home into one combined journey to save petrol costs, then did all my errands in one day, which resulted in experiencing fatigue and a day mostly in bed." So several of the diary participants reflected that they were so used to having extra costs of living related to their disability or their health conditions, that over time they had come to almost normalise these costs. So it had become part of their routine and part of their weekly budgets. So when we did the interviews at the start of the project, quite a few of the participants were saying that it had become just so normal to them that they have these costs that they have to manage every week. So I'm going to read out a bit from Jenny's case study, which really illustrates the financial difficulty she was experiencing, how that was impacting on her mental and physical health. So Jenny, who has several health conditions and is in receipt of personal independence payment, her health conditions means she needs to buy more expensive food, and also that she's restricted and must stay inside more. In the 5 weeks of the taking part in the diary, she had to buy shopping on her credit card frequently, as she did not have enough money left after putting aside money for energy bills. In her week three diary, she gave a specific example that she and her partner had to cut showers back to every few days to preserve electricity and to be able to have enough money to put the heating on. She said, "This will obviously cost me more in the long run, but I live from week to week, hoping the next one will be better." She noted the weekly effects on her mental health, as well as the negative effects on her relationship with her partner and her family. And she said that the stress exacerbated her symptoms, writing, "It is stressful and wearing, and I often find myself on the edge of depression, struggling to stay out of it." The next case study from another participant really illustrates the experiences around accessing social care support. So this was a participant who had a physical disability at the highest rate for care and mobility, and was using quite a big proportion of his income to have a social care assistant. So he specifically said that he uses his PIP to hire personal assistants, and also regularly has to use it for travel to and from work, as his transport expenses from his employer can take months to receive. He recorded that he had gone without basic essentials in all of his diary entries as well. And he wrote in one diary, "It isn't unusual to use this benefit, so personal independence payment, in half the time it should cover." And he shared that distinguishing what his additional costs are was difficult, as he feels that he has normalised those costs over time, and therefore he's adapted and has to make his own solutions due to a lack of available social care support in his local area. And he said specifically, and at a wider level, a lack of recognition of the social model of disability. Another issue that he raised when we did the interviews at the start of the project was around housing and it not being accessible for his needs, meaning that he cannot access and managing the energy in his house by himself. So a consequence of this, he shared, was that he often has to sit in his flat wearing a hat and thermals and layers of clothes with an electric fire in winter. A big issue for him was the lack of personal assistance available in his local authority, and meaning that he's often feeling that he's having to call on friends, family for support, which he said he does not want to do. And therefore he's often not able to access the support that he needs. So he shared the following impacts in his diary entry. So 1 week, his shopping and house cleaning was shelved, so he wasn't able to have that support that week, so that he could go to a social event instead and get support for that. And in week five, he said, "I'd love to have greater personal assistance support and use it when I need it, rather than generally trying to fit in with the paid worker in terms of what their availability is." And he said, "I'd love to have access to a resource that is user-led, such as the service run by Glasgow Centre for Independent Living." So I'm just going to pass back to Kirsty now for just some final conclusions from the research.
Yeah, thanks. So, yeah, just to conclude, spending data from the Living Costs and Food Survey shows that disabled households in Scotland spend slightly more in essential categories, such as health and energy, but less on transport. However, as we've seen from the diaries, disabled households could be rationing essential spending due to financial difficulty. The LCFS data is far from perfect. Small sample sizes are a problem at the Scotland level, particularly when we start to look at severe disability in urban versus rural households. We've put some more information on sample sizes in the appendices. And importantly, the spending data doesn't capture what households need but cannot afford. The diary entries show that the six participants' incomes are not providing consistent, adequate levels of income for additional costs associated with having a disability or health condition. While these diaries do not represent all disabled households in Scotland, there have been other studies which show similar findings on a wider scale. So, for example, Scope in 2023 looked at the difference in material deprivation levels between disabled and non-disabled households and found that disabled people's incomes, including disability benefits, provided a lower standard of living when compared to non-disabled households on the same income across the UK. The impacts of the cost of living crisis on deepening levels of poverty amongst disabled people has been evidenced in various qualitative and quantitative research. In particular, people with disabilities in the UK have been affected by rising energy and food prices and are more vulnerable to increases in these essential costs as they make up a higher proportion of their budgets than for non-disabled people. Recent qualitative research commissioned by the Trussell Trust found a near consensus that disability payment levels were too low to meet the extra costs associated with physical and mental health conditions. For some of the participants in the diary exercise, a lack of available support from the social care system, including personal assistance, was a recurring challenge, and therefore there are wider implications around social care support that meets the needs of people with a disability or health condition in Scotland. Getting the right social care support in place could reduce the additional costs that disabled people face. Some of the interviews also highlight the importance of the right housing that better meets people's needs, and that, which is also a crucial issue. So going forward, policymakers will need to think carefully about how to measure additional costs of disability and the adequacy of benefits and other public services to ensure an evidence-driven approach. We do not believe that there is an existing source of quantitative data that can provide robust enough evidence on the additional costs of disability in Scotland. And even if this was the case, the personal nature of disabilities means that costs are likely to differ markedly between different people. So an effective evidence-based policy to meet additional costs of disability will need to recognise that rather than assuming a one-size-fits-all approach. So that's us. We're happy to take questions.
Okay, thanks very much. And before I invite anyone in for questioning, can I just apologise because I introduced you as Kirsty when it's actually Kirsty. So My humble apologies to you, Kirsty. So obviously, the research that you've given us has been really, really useful in terms of, you know, and the insights into the costs or the hidden costs with disabilities, and the extra costs as well. Do you, as researchers, have any suggestions on the best way to approach further research on this particular issue as well? And if I can just invite Kirsty in first of all, thanks.
Yeah, thank you. So one of the main things that I spoke about is that if we want this evidence-driven policy approach, then we need more evidence. So something that some surveys in Scotland have, such as the Labour Force Survey and the Annual Population Survey, is a Scottish boost that's paid for by Scottish Government, which means that we have better sample sizes and we can have better data on that. So that's one option of improving sample sizes if we want to have more kind of robust evidence on this. But as we said, it's also so much to do with whether the appropriate social support is in place. So a lot of times, in the diaries, we'd seen that a lack of social support was causing extra costs for people with disabilities. So I think also looking more into whether social support and social care is adequate and where there are barriers to accessing that support could be really, really useful in thinking about sort of what are the additional costs of disability that we can't get rid of through, you know, better policies in other areas.
I don't know, Dr. Laura, if you would like to come in on that as well.
Yeah, so there, we've already referenced other qualitative research from the Glasgow Disability Alliance, and Inclusion Scotland have also published research last year about the impacts of increased cost of living and deepening poverty for disabled people. In terms of further research, I would always recommend more research about lived experiences. This was obviously quite a short-term, quite small-scale project, and we weren't looking to have a very diverse sample, so we haven't spoken to families, for example, with a disabled child or a disabled adult. So there's research that could be looking at those different experiences and how households are managing. I also think that with the ongoing impacts of the cost of living crisis, more longitudinal research that followed people with a disability or a health condition over time. Obviously, we were limited. We were just looking at a five-week period to see at different time points of the year and how are they managing at different points. Obviously, this was in January when energy costs are higher. Would also be really important evidence base to have.
Okay, that's really helpful. Now, I'm going to open it up to our members, and I wonder if you want to come in, Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener, and thanks for your time this morning. Obviously, in your conclusion there, obviously you recommended that, you know, careful consideration given to additional costs of disability and how inadequate benefits levels are. Are you aware of kind of any other countries across the globe that are kind of we could learn really if they're sort of doing it right? I know it's obviously if you don't have an answer today, even kind of feedback to the committee, it'd be quite interesting to see how other countries elsewhere are doing.
Mm-hmm. So we have done some work on learning disabilities from the Fraser Allender Institute, and some of the work we've done on data has been quite useful, learning from other countries. So like New Zealand, for example, they do their census, sort of similar periods to us, but what they do is when they find that people have a type of disability that they're interested in learning more about, they will then do like a sort of booster survey that kind of brings more information in on that. So I think that's probably something we can learn from more generally in terms of, I don't know of any other countries that are doing it right. I think it's one of those complicated issues that everyone is trying to get better at. But yeah, we'd definitely be keen to have a look at that more and maybe feedback to you later.
It would be great. Thank you. Cheers.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Jeremy in. Thanks. And then I'll bring in John. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you very much for it. I think it's helpful to read this report also in light of the other report you did recently on disability and employment, and actually they go quite well together, and all raise quite a lot of questions around that. There are a number of questions I would like to ask, but for time, let me ask just one, which is quite a long question. But that is, our Deputy Convener will always tell me we have political choices to make of how we spend our money, and he's absolutely right on that. So, but can I put that over to you for a moment and say, if you had another £20 million to spend, would you make it a universal benefit for disabled people? So would you increase adult disability payment, or would you target it in some way? Because I think it was Dr. Robertson that said, it's not one meet. Disabled people have different needs and different ways. So how do we target this money if we had it? Is it through a universal benefit, or is there another more nuanced way you can do it around that?
So for me, I think it comes back to that commitment to have evidence-based policymaking. We've only done a sort of short-term study here, but there is more work that could be done to kind of understand this issue better. And I think that the first thing I would do with money would be to try and gather that evidence more so that we really have a good understanding of exactly what additional costs are, where needs are not being met, and then base policy and benefits on that. Because from the evidence that we've gathered, I couldn't tell you how to spend the money. And so I know that that's even harder for you guys to then sort of try and decide where to put things. So for me, it's definitely about gathering more evidence first and trying to really understand the issue so that we're not spending money in a way that then ends up not being something that's evidence-led, and we end up having to go back and do things again. So, yeah.
Could I? Just to come in as well. So, from Poverty Alliance's perspective, so outside of this research that we've been doing, that we would be calling for increase in incomes for people with disability that are living in poverty in Scotland. In the session that was on just before ours, one of the witnesses said that just over half of people in relative poverty live in a household where there's somebody with a disability. So that there's clear evidence just now that there are people with disabilities are more likely to be living in poverty. So I think that there are decisions that should be made to increase incomes for people who have a disability. By what means, I'm not sure, but it's clear that it's not adequate at the moment.
I suppose that's the issue I'm trying to work out, Dr. Robertson, because I suppose, personally, I probably fall into income group 5. But if you increase adult disability payment, I will benefit as much as somebody within income group 1. And I suppose what I'm trying to work out, and I don't have the answer, but I'm trying to work out, is how do we increase the income of group 1, 2, and 3, maybe, but not necessarily direct that to groups 4 and 5, who, although will have extra cost, can probably meet those. And I suppose what I'm looking for is a way of how we identify those individuals. Now, maybe it's not the data there yet that we have, I mean, to find that, but I'm concerned that if we just simply do it universally, although everyone benefits, it doesn't benefit those we need it more enough, if that makes sense.
The example that was discussed in the previous session around Scottish Child Payment and learning from that. So obviously that's a passported benefit for families that are receiving universal credit and other eligible benefits. So, and that has been successful in pulling a lot of families out of poverty, so that is something that has been a really successful policy in Scotland. So there's useful learning there about identifying families that are already struggling. One thing that I would caution is obviously there's a lot of people in Scotland currently in work poverty and low paid work who may not be getting one of those eligible benefits, and then also they will have those support needs as well. And yeah, so thinking around about that and making sure that there aren't certain households, particularly those in low pay work, that are missing out.
Thank you, Camino.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm just going to invite John Mason in now. Thank you.
Hey, thanks, Convener. I was struck, starting with a specific on your, is it page 4, figure 1, where the transport costs in particular were quite starkly different. That maybe follows on from Jeremy Balfour's point. But it was very interesting that the highest income group, if I'm reading this correctly, is that the blue line, has dropped the most dramatically. And I suppose, I mean, one of your themes seems to be that this is affecting, disability affects a lot of different people in a lot of different ways. So, for example, some disabled people can still drive and some disabled people can't. So that presumably would be a major factor. If you have to give up your car, your costs are going to drop dramatically. But you also make the point about spending doesn't equal needs. And I am guessing there are some people who are disabled who would be able to drive but just cannot possibly afford the cost of a car. I don't know with the transport one. I mean, what is it actually telling me? Is it telling me there's a great need there that's not being met? Or is it telling me that the concession card system is so good that people don't need cost?
So I think it's a combination of things. I think the first thing that stands out to me is that we do have UK evidence that disabled people travel less than non-disabled people. And so I think that is something to potentially look at as to the reasons why that is happening. So why are disabled people travelling less? Is it because they don't have access? Is it because it's a lack of affordability? We don't know. But I think that's something that could be looked into more, definitely. And then, yes, as I said before, with concession bus passes, we don't know who has one in this data. So we can't tell if people are travelling and just not spending money on it. But from the sort of larger numbers here, it seems like the sort of prevailing thing that's happening is that people are just travelling less when they're disabled. And so I think that's something to look at in terms of disabled people having access to society and being able to travel where they want to and when they want to. And it's something that we see as well with the extra costs in energy. We know that disabled people are spending more time at home, which means the energy costs can be higher, having to heat their homes. So yeah, it's all kind of tied in. But yeah, it's definitely something that could be looked at more.
Right, so that follows on then. So the message is we need a much more in-depth and bigger survey. Yes, I think we're maybe all agreed on that. Who should actually do that? I mean, is it best for the government to do that, or is it maybe a third sector organisation, or what?
It's difficult to say. I mean, what I always come back to is as long as something is well-resourced, that's what's important. If it's well-designed and well-resourced, then we'll get the evidence that we need. So working in partnership, if government wanted to do it, working in partnership with organisations that have specific in-depth knowledge about these kinds of things, about disability, about poverty, about incomes, could be really useful. But yeah, I guess it would be up to you.
Okay, and maybe a final one, if I may. I mean, you said how there's this kind of split between your activities are affected a lot or affected a little. Is that too basic? Do we need to really get into a lot more detail on that?
So I would say, based on the data that we have, we shouldn't be splitting things any further because it's already really difficult to understand. But Jeremy mentioned some of my other work that we've been doing on the disability employment gap, for example, and we've seen that in the disability employment gap, people with different types of disability, their employment gaps are closing faster or slower. So in the long term, and in an ideal world, yes, we do need more evidence on specific types of disability and who has additional costs based on what needs they have. But with the current data that we have, cutting the data into any sort of smaller chunks would mean we're looking at maybe one or two people in the sample, which is obviously not useful for us. So again, it goes back to that sort of, if we have more resource to collect more information, then yes, we would definitely want to split by something that's more. But yeah, we use that because it is the kind of national definition that's used in terms of disability. But yes, types of disability would definitely be really good to look at.
OK, I wasn't sure if you wanted to come in, Dr Robertson, or was that... Most of my questions were aimed at Ms McFadden, I think.
No, I think Kirsty's the expert on the questions that you asked.
Thanks, convener.
Thanks very much. I believe that was Jeremy offering up your services again, Kirsty, for further research. So thank you. I'm going to now invite Bob Doddison. Thanks.
Thanks, convener. And thank you for the name check from the Mr Balfour as well. In the earlier session, I suggested an imaginary £10 million extra. It's doubled in the space of half an hour. Mr Balfour's played with a £20 million that doesn't exist. I suppose I wanted to ask a wee bit about what's not in the survey. And I get there's data issues and there's massive restrictions on what both of you were able to collect and analyse. The Scottish Child Payment's been mentioned. I had a wee look there, and the interim review of the Scottish Child Payment from July 2022 indicates that 16%, now I'm not sure if it's applicants or recipients, but around 16% of people in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment at that point had a disabled person in the household. So it may be we've got a benefit already that supports those living with disabilities where there's a child in the household and the household's on benefits. And in fact, that report suggested that because 8% didn't want to say if there was a physical or mental issue within the household, that there could be underreporting. So it could be up to 24% of Scottish Child Payment payments may go to households with a disabled person in there. So I think it was Ms McFadden that suggested that has had an impact, but it may also have an impact for disabled families. Now, I'm not asking you a question about what's not in the report, but did that come on your radar at any point? Because that's quite a significant positive impact, if so, but it also begs the question, what are we doing for households where there's poverty and a disabled person where there's not children there? And I get that as well, so the consistency of approach. Any comments on that, perhaps, Ms McFadden?
So we didn't look at any benefits in terms of the data that we were looking at. We looked at disability benefits briefly, but we didn't include it in the final report because we were finding very similar results. Whether people with disabilities were claiming or not, we were seeing similar extra costs. Yeah, it would be interesting to look at that in terms of Scottish Child Payment. But yeah, we decided to look at the household as a unit in this research because we kind of recognised that the household is generally what receives benefits. And so, yeah, I mean, you could definitely have a point there, but we haven't looked at it specifically. I don't know if, Laura, you have any thoughts on, like, qualitatively?
Yeah, well, obviously we were very limited with this research. I mentioned that it didn't include families, so we weren't asking... There wasn't anything around Scottish Child Payment there, so I think if it was families experiencing, you want to capture. I'm not sure without checking, but obviously Inclusion and Glasgow Disability Alliance have both published research in the last year, qualitative research and quantitative survey data about the impacts on different types of households. So there might be evidence relevant to your question there.
That's helpful. I should note that my understanding is the Social Security Scotland doesn't routinely collect data on households claiming Scottish Child Payment where there's a disability. Maybe that's something that they have to improve their own data collection on. But do we know how many families... Do we know the split between disabled households living in poverty where there are children there or there's not children? Do we know the split in relation to that?
I couldn't tell you the numbers off the top of my head, but they should be available in national surveys. I don't know if it would be in the Social Security Scotland one or in the... It would probably be in Family Resources Survey, potentially. But, yeah, I personally don't know that figure.
Okay.
I couldn't either. The big source of data as well is the Joseph Rowntree Foundation's annual report, and I'm not sure if they've broken it down by that, but that would be the first place I would look also.
It's just because of the political choices that Mr Balfour was referencing would be the Scottish Child Payment will have an impact in some household where there's a disability but in poverty, but not others. So we get to see the ones that we have to maybe drive a focus on. I think Mr. Balfour was suggesting, or floating the idea rather than suggesting, of targeting an additional resource. Did either of you look at, ultimately, the way that we get money to people in need in society in Scotland and across the UK for those of working age is through the benefit system, and predominantly that's universal credit. So did either of our witnesses look at the sufficiency or otherwise of how universal credit recognises disability within households in terms of addressing poverty?
We haven't looked at that. So, yeah, as we said, this was a very limited study. So we really have just looked at the Living Costs and Food Survey and the six diarists. So, yeah, it would definitely be an opportunity for further research to look into that.
Right. That's very helpful. I think the final thing I would say is just maybe a comment. And it's a very brief one, convener, and that is I can't not reflect in the comments that both of you have made in relation to pressures on social service provision and meeting the care needs of families or individuals where there's someone living with disability. And I think we will maybe draw it to the attention of the lead committee that looks at that kind of thing as a matter of course, but I just wanted to reflect that I have listened to what you've said in that area.
Okay, thanks. Don't know. Did Dr. Laura, did you want to come in there?
Nothing really to add, but yeah, just that was very clear and for the participants out of the six, just that lack of accessible support locally and then having to make decisions what they used it for and also having to use their PIP for a large proportion of that as well, which was quite an interesting finding.
Okay, thanks very much. I don't know if any other members have any other questions at this point. No. Okay, so thank you very much for undertaking this research and presenting your findings to us today. It will obviously no doubt be very useful for the committee's ongoing scrutiny of benefits in Scotland and future inquiry work as well. So that concludes our public business for today, and we will now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. And thank you once again for joining us. Thank you. Thank you.